Simon & Schuster Audio presents Death Valley, a novel by Melissa Broder, read by the author.
For my father.
1. I pull into the desert town at sunset feeling empty. I felt empty the whole drive from Los Angeles, and hoped that my arrival would alleviate the emptiness. So when the emptiness is not alleviated, not even momentarily, all emptiness alleviators are temporary. I feel emptier. Help me not be empty, I say to God, in the Best Western parking lot. Since I don't turn to God very often, I feel self-conscious when I do. I'm not sure what I'm allowed to ask for, and I worry that I shouldn't want the things I want. Are my requests too specific? I should probably ask to simply be happy doing God's will, though I've heard it said that when you're doing God's will, you feel like you're flowing with a great river, not against it. So it seems like the happy feeling should just come naturally. Earlier today, a friend texted me a quote by Kierkegaard: "Life is not a problem to be solved, but a reality to be experienced." Ordinarily, I'd do nothing more than mark this kind of text message with a heart, maybe respond with the word, yes, and move on. But because of the low place I've been in, I saw the quote as a life raft, as though I were a small version of me adrift in a bowl of milk, and the quote was the lone Cheerio I had to grab onto. Halfway between LA and the desert town, I stopped at a Circle K to pee and get some beef jerky. On the public toilet, I tried to meditate using the Kierkegaard quote as a mantra, but the quote only made me feel worse. I realized that I was doing the exact opposite of what the quote suggested, trying to solve a problem, the problem of me and my mood, rather than just experiencing it. But how do you just experience things? In addition to the beef jerky, Jack Link's brand, sweet and hot, I bought a large cup of black coffee and 2 cans of Red Bull sugar-free, a decision that is now coming back to haunt me in the motel parking lot. Some bad electricity is going down in my nervous system, and I can't tell what's caffeine-induced sensitivity and what could be a real physical problem. When I look at the glowing blue welcome sign, it appears to be vibrating. The Best Western is at the edge of town, and beyond it lies nothingness, a desolate stretch of sand and rock, peppered with dead brush all the way to the hills. I play it fake cool to the dust, casually unloading my black duffel from the trunk, but my hands are trembling. Am I dying? This thought triggers an unexpected surge of tenderness, as though I am a child who needs comforting. In the settling dusk, I try to think of a positive self-affirmation, the kind that one woman I know has written on post-its stuck to her bathroom mirror, a behavior that makes me judge her as a person, though there's really nothing wrong with it, and I wish I didn't. What I come up with is, "You have a good reason to be depressed." The phrase serves as a soothing reminder that my doominess isn't baseless. I am going to clutch it like a blankie as I move through the gloom, deeper and more alarming than my typical sea levels. My raison de depression, if I were to convey it briefly in an email, is thus. Hi. 5 months ago, my father was critically injured in a car accident. Unfortunately, he is still in the ICU. As a result, I am overextended and cannot fulfill your request at this time. Best, me. One nice thing about a tragic situation is having an excuse to say no to everything. Nothing says, "Don't ask me for shit," like "I see you." It's simple, effective, succinct. At the same time, my prevailing compulsion is to recount every stage of the whole ordeal, as though, by omission, I'll fail to convey the prolonged awfulness of the situation. Or worse, I'll lose some of the time in which my father and I have existed on Earth together. When asked, "How are you?" never a good question, I keep bursting into monologue. His accident, his broken neck, the aspiration, the sedation, the surgery, the failure to wean off the ventilator, the prolonged unconsciousness, the tracheotomy, the awakening, the bronchoscopy, and 5-second death. The second death, the decision, the really awakening, the weaning success, the collar, the sound of his voice, the pneumonia, the falling unconscious again. Sometimes, mid-monologue, I catch myself calling my father's tracheal tube a trach and his ventilator a vent, a breezy familiarity that disgusts me, as though the life support machines are now my friends. For the sake of narrative clarity, I do my best to organize the flood of events into temporal subheadings like Unconsciousness 1 and Resuscitation 2. During the period of Unconsciousness 1, my younger sister and I went to visit our father in the ICU most evenings. Through our tears, we smiled at the nurses, feeling righteous and kind. What devoted children we were. What bringers of light. From our mouths burbled fountains of I love yous. We could not stop saying it if we tried. We tucked him in each night, reading aloud from Pat the Bunny, The Great Blueness, and other bedtime classics from our faraway past. We sang Puff the Magic Dragon and The Bear Went Over the Mountain, the ventilator swishing behind us for rhythm. It is easier to have an intimate relationship with the unconscious than the conscious, the dead than the living. As my father slumbered, I created a fantasy version of him, resurrecting the man from my youth, before his depression set in. I re-entered a world of home-cooked stews, tobacco smells, cozy sweatshirts, plants, and birds, a realm of warmth and worldly cynicism, where I was always on the inside of his sarcasm. My father is more at ease with children than adults. At 21, I was surprised to find that I could be a them, displaced beyond the gates of his prickly emotional garden. Now, at 41, I told myself a new story. If my father survived, if he awoke and had some kind of meaningful recovery, then I would have the father from my childhood back. But I am no longer a child. When my father regained consciousness, he wouldn't make eye contact with me. I looked at his hands and feet instead. The feet were easy. Calluses, freckle on big toe, him. But looking at his left hand was like seeing him naked, like I should have to ask permission first. What was once his dominant hand, his scrawling, gardening, cooking, and hauling hand, now lay limp with nails overgrown and skin covered in purple blotches. Gently, I took his hand in mine. He allowed me to hold it for a few seconds. Then he pulled away. "He probably doesn't know who we are," said my sister. But I took it personally, and in the periods of consciousness that followed, I mounted a new campaign to connect with him. It had taken me years to see clearly that I was not the cause of my father's depression. Still, I never stopped hoping that I could be an exception to it. Now the accident was a second hurdle to overcome, and I wanted to be the magic daughter. I'd live in that garden once more. But before I could take root, my father fell unconscious again. This time, I fled to the desert. I'm here at the Best Western for a week under the pretext of figuring out the desert section of my next novel. If I'm honest, I came to escape a feeling, an attempt that's already going poorly, because unfortunately, I've brought myself with me, and I see, as the last pink light creeps out to infinity, that I am still the kind of person who makes another person's coma all about me. 2. I chose this desert town as the scene of my escape because it's the fictional home of a cartoon bighorn sheep that enchanted both my father and me in childhood. Whenever I see the town on a map, just north of the Mojave Preserve and south of Death Valley, in the Valley of Death Valley, you might say, it makes me smile. According to Google, the town now has 2 non-chain restaurants, a 50s diner and a Mexican automat, plus a Wendy's, a Jack in the Box, and other highway fare. There's a general store and trading post, an alien-themed gift shop, a small Route 66 museum, a dinosaur park, and a Target. There are 5 motels. I was pleased to discover online that one of the motels is a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.